Hey, it's Dylan, and I'm gonna show you how to disappear. Okay. Ready? Bye.
That was when I was 10 years old. And when I saw online that you could take a regular shot, put a static background plate, and then two cross dissolves, and it looked like you could disappear, that's when I fell in love with visual effects. And with this passion, as I turned 12, that's when I got serious. That's when I downloaded action movie FX, and then Gun FX and Pyro FX, whatever. They were in a bundle, okay? That's when the high quality stuff came, like this. Or this. Or maybe this.
Hashtag YOLO.
And as a 12-year-old, I mainly focus on action. I mean, I still do, but it was more just gun muzzle flashes and plane crashes into sisters and other things of that nature. And while you can barely call this visual effects, it did start to get me to think in the mindset of adding in pre-made assets into footage that I captured. And you know, you learn the most from failure, and that's what I would consider these. And so by the time I was 13-ish, I tried my first coherent movie.
Shadow Assassin. And although this is dangerous, it's the path that I have chosen.
White shadows. I know. Pretty intense. that was the crowning achievement of my teenage kind of years. And while it's pretty much unbearable to watch unless you're watching it for comedic effect, I was pretty proud at the time, and I guess I kind of am now, that at that age I was able to commit to a full-length project. Though as middle school ended and, you know, my first couple of years of high school passed, I really only touched video editing software when I was making YouTube videos when I turned around 15-ish, maybe a little older. And it would be later into my high school career, my junior, senior year specifically, where I would kind of reignite that passion for visual effects.
Nani?
Motomoto likes you.
Here he comes.
I like him big. I like him chunky. I like him.
Oh, that's hot.
Masterpieces, I know. You don't have to tell me. While these are bad, no doubt about it, it was just fun for me, and they were stupid school little projects, but you know, it got me familiar with Premiere Pro and After Effects, and I started to really enjoy myself. Even though they were god-awful movies, I really started to love making, you know, visual effects again. And it felt a lot better than just going into an app and hitting where I wanted the things, and it felt more like I was actually creating something. Then as college began, I started to take classes. And while I've watched just about every YouTube tutorial, nothing really beats being in person in class getting instruction on how to do things. And while they were intro courses, it gave me a solid foundation to be able to feel more confident doing the things I wanted to do, which led to my first project.
She said 2 miles, right? Let's give this a shot. This ought to stop her.
While this is still pretty marginally better than my earlier projects, since it's the same concept of adding in pre-made assets with a little bit of stuff on my own, what really helped it was the storyboarding process, as well as my most recent project. These were all heavily aided by a storyboard, and I think it's the skeleton that all films need to have, especially even at this amateur level, which I really didn't know was so essential at even the level I'm doing. See, the main problem with Wedge Shadows is that I would just go out with a camera and just try to get the shots. Had no plan, no nothing. Then as I entered college, I learned about storyboarding. So I guess the main point of this video is to just show you how storyboarding improved my work and how you would go about making a storyboard at this kind of amateur intro level. And it all starts with brainstorming. Now, this is just getting ideas onto paper, not thinking about whether they're good or not, or I mean, I guess putting a little thought into that, but just trying to get as much content as you can onto paper. You can throw as much as you want out later, but the point is just to get that ball rolling. Then after you've brainstormed, which can be as long as a process as you want or as short, if you know you have a good idea, you can turn into rough sketching. Now this is when you want to start thinking about what specifically type of shots you want to get. And I'll show examples of how I use this in my films. So through rough sketching, you can really start to see how the pace of the movie will go and, you know, what specific maybe camera angles you want, what expressions. It's really going to help with the next step, which is getting your project greenlit. And greenlit is just a film way of saying approved. So for me, it's getting approved by a professor, but if you're actually, you know, making a short film, you might need to get this approved by investors or, you know, higher up, or directors, or producers, or things like that. Stuff that I have no experience with, so I can't really talk on it. But having that rough sketch helps you present your ideas in, you know, a very, you know, linear fashion to whoever you need to. And once your project is greenlit, you can start doing some more in-depth work, like image referencing, which, you know, you can go out on location, you know, to get reference material that you can show whatever staff you may need to, you know, cinematographers. I'm all these roles for my little stupid school projects, but if you need to convey to maybe an actor where they need to be in a certain shot, a storyboard can be essential for that, since you don't really have any, you know, footage to go off of. And then finally is the shooting process. And what I like to do when I go out to shoot is have a list of shots that I want to get. And I get multiple takes of one shot because it's the worst feeling to go into post and not have enough footage to work with, which I kind of have experienced on some of my school projects. And it really isn't fun. So always get more than you need and you can get rid of later, kind of like with the brainstorming process. You can always get rid of what you don't want. So it's better to have more than less. And while some of this, you know, seems like common sense, when you're out trying to shoot, it's pretty chaotic. It's nice to have a reference point. And then the other thing about the storyboard is, while it is a skeleton, it's not set in stone. So you can go and kind of improvise some shots if, you know, your storyboard has something that you don't want, you don't necessarily have to stick to it. I mean, you can capture it, just like I said, for more is always better, and then get rid of it if you don't like it. But don't be afraid to go outside your storyboard if you want to try things on set. Or some of the best, you know, shots I get are improvised, just because on location I'll see something that looks good, so I'll go out and shoot it, even though it's not necessarily on my storyboard. And that's really my process. I guess this video is just mainly to share with you my experience and, you know, my film history, and how recently just this process of storyboarding can make a huge impact. And while yes, I'm older and I have more experience now, that real factor, if I had storyboards back then, or I mean, you can have storyboards, whatever, it's just a matter of creating them. If I knew about this tool, my films would probably be a lot more nice to watch. So that's gonna do it for this video. I hope it was somewhat informative, maybe entertaining. And I'll catch you guys in the next one.